Hello, Brooklyn. Hello, Mr. Ken Thompson, the district attorney in Brooklyn. Hello, the Jewish community, and hello, all communities that are created from God equal. I would like to discuss something that happened this week, and I think we have a lot to learn from this. What happened was, there is a man whose name is Milos Schnitzler, a 38-year-old ultra-Orthodox Hasidic man. He's also the sexton, the shamus, in one of the Satmar shuls. He has a fish store, or he works in the fish store on Roebling Street. One fine day, it was the next morning after the arrest of Nehemiah Weberman, who got not much. He got 103 years from Judge Ingram. It was so much that the government discounted him, and they said they would let him go after 50 years, so he gets a discount of 53 years. The next day, Mr. Schnitzler pours bleach in my face. The way the story happened was as follows. I was walking down from Division Avenue towards Broadway on the odd-numbered side of the street. There is a very big liquor store. It was like 11 in the morning, and the liquor store was about to open, and I walked down the street on Roebling, minding my business, and all of a sudden, somebody taps me on my shoulder. I turn around to see who it is, and he pours, I don't know, a glass or a pitcher of Clorox bleach in my face. I was blinded on one eye, totally, and on the other eye, I was still able to see, and I saw who did it. I saw him before he poured the two. I didn't imagine that this is coming. I've never heard of such evil behavior. Anyway, the liquor store was about to open his store, and he said, Rabbi, I'm going to open my store and I'm going to bring you water. You have to wash yourself up. But by the time he went to get the water, it was hurting very bad. So I ran to the next store, which is a telephone shop, and I know him because I pay my bills in his phone shop, and he's a very nice, lovely guy. And I said, somebody just attacked me with bleach. He says, well, go over to the machine that gives out the water and put yourself on as much water as you can. Take a cup, pour outside, not in the store because you'll make a mess, but as much as you need, go and come and pour. Meanwhile, the liquor store opened and he had a big pitcher and he brought it out and I was washing my eyes. Then the liquor man, who by the way, he's a Gentile, he's a Puerto Rican, and that was the good part about it, because had he been Jewish, he never would have came forward to say what happened, because this is our community. And Mr. Thompson, you still got a long way to learn our community. Anyway, the Puerto Rican man said to me, he's probably the owner of the liquor store, he said, Rabbi, call 911. I was lost, because usually we should call Datsola. But I was afraid also, because maybe Datsola won't give me service. Because I'm ostracized in this community. What my ostracization calls for is that if I go by a big pit, which is like 10 feet deep, they're allowed to push me in, and I should fall down and get killed. And of course, it's understood that they're not supposed to help me out if they see me down in the pit. Unbelievable what these filthy, ugly, low-life rabbis in our community did, because they wanted to fight for their survival. Sex and money and power. And we wanted to bring that down. They're not allowed to touch anybody. They're not allowed to, in their own ritual baths, to touch our children. They're not allowed to ask our women for sexual favors, which they've been doing. And we have to stop this. Now, when the 911 came, they also came along with police, because it was an attack in the middle of the street. I was rushed into Woodhall Hospital, and I got a very good doctor there. He took very good care of me. Thank God. It took basically a day and a half until I got back my sight. It was a retina embrosure. And I still have my ups and downs. I still have problems. I go to Will's Eye Hospital in Philadelphia, which is one of the biggest hospitals in this country. And I'm existing, you know, not the easiest way of life, but I'm existing. Okay. Then, while I was still washing my eyes, the police came, and I told them exactly what happened, that this Mr. Schnitzel patted me on my left side, and when I turned around, he immediately threw the glass or the pitcher of Clorox that he had. It was all over my clothes and so forth and so on. Now, this Puerto Rican man He's probably the owner of the store. It was very helpful. I never went in to thank him because I didn't want that the Satmar community should say that I went in and I gave him money, you know, like with Mr. Kellner's story. I tried to offer him $50,000. He should say a lie. You know these people. You have to know them. The unfortunate thing is Mr. Thompson does not know them. And he took him into his office, one of the people, when I heard that he hired him, I said, watch and see, in 4 years, Mr. Thompson will be a total flip, because I know the community. Now, if he only he would have asked me, I mean, I tried to help out Mr. Abe George, and then I tried to help him out. The only thing is that there were a lot of people that told him a lot of bad things about me, that he didn't want to even ask me for my advice. So, listen, if you don't ask, I don't give it. Anyway. So, I never went in to thank the man, but I really thank him for whatever he did. He was very helpful. While I was still washing my eyes, the police were there, and he gave him testimony that he saw me coming down from Division Avenue on this side the whole time, because he was in the middle of opening the gates of his store. And he also said, I was wondering what my neighbor was doing, going out and going around in the back, crossing the street and coming in the back of this man. I couldn't figure it out that he was holding a cup of something. So the police asked, do you know this man? He says, of course, he's a neighbor for years. He has a fish store there. So this is what happened. And then I was hospitalized. I came out the same day. It was just, you know, a few hours until they tried to put everything together. I had my ups and downs for a few days, and thank God everything grew back together. I went back to Will's Eye Hospital to check everything out. And I also went to a very big specialist here in Brooklyn. And I have my small ups and downs. And I told this for my assistant DA, Mr. Farkas. I showed him I always have to go around with a certain eye drop and so forth and so on. And the other things I don't want to discuss in public. So at the end of the day, a man attacked me and he injured me. And he was supposed to go to court. So he took a very big lawyer. He came down. He claimed not guilty. It's all a lie. It wasn't him. It was somebody else. First of all, he ran away for 2 days. And then after 2 days, the police got a call from his lawyer that he's going to come. He's going to identify himself. And he comes. They didn't even need my identification on him because he admitted everything himself. Okay, so now we're going to step number two. He came about a year and a half, on and off, every few months.
Any changes to a new lawyer?
Izzy Fried. Izzy Fried takes care of most of the pedophiles in our community. He's not so big a lawyer as he knows the inside people. He's so involved with this community, with Mr. Dov Hyken, that crook. And the reason why I call him a crook is because I want you to know, Mr. Dov Hyken took a list of a few hundred children and grown-ups who were molested in the community. He said he'll try to do anything. He went to Albany. He got loads of money. Mr. Hyken, Mr. Sheldon Silver, and Mr. Joe Lazar. They got millions of dollars. We want to know what happened to that money. Where did they put it? After they caught this unfortunate, lovely child, Mr. Kaletsky, they cut him up like salami. They cut him up like roast beef. And everybody was crying. Dov Hyken didn't have the courtesy to put on the electronic eyes, the videos that the government is giving us. It's still not on. They're still fighting who should look if a crime would happen. The man is such a low life. We know his history still back when he was in the Jewish Defense League with Mayor Kahana. We know his history all along that he stole from the government with the Kojo. We know everything about him. The man is a low, low life politician. But he makes sure that the rabbis get fed with the money that they need. He was supposed to sign on one of the curriculums that the government is giving money on that no child should be thrown out of school. He didn't sign it because he's not going to interfere with the rabbis. I went up to his office once and I said, Mr. Hyken, I have a hotline which I teach boys and girls to be aware on sexual abuse and on pedophiles. Nobody should attack you. And I said, they ostracized me. So he said, I'll call up. So he calls a Berish Freilich, a crook number one, who was thrown out from the state police. A Berish Freilich calls him back in 2 hours. He says, get that man out of your office. He's an ostracization. The rabbis won't vote for you. So he calls up another man. His name is Moshe David Niederman. And he asked him the same thing. Why is Rabbi Rosenberg not allowed to have a hotline? Isn't it freedom of speech? He calls back an half hour later, throw him out of your office. You'll ruin your reputation with the rabbis. Now, this is what Mr. Thompson does not understand.
Mr. Thompson doesn't understand that the rabbis run this community. They're all the ones that run it, not all of them. The ones that run it are evil. They're into politics, into sex, into extorting money. Every time we go to them to a civil court, a rabbinic civil court, they would extort monies. Nobody goes to them. They all go now, unfortunately, to the secular court. The only one that goes to rabbinic court today is if somebody wants to become an informer on somebody else, then that somebody else runs to the rabbi, make sure you stop the informer, and make sure you ostracize him. That's what's happening here. Mr. Thompson, you would need a very big lecture of our community and of the people who you are dealing with. I don't understand you altogether, Mr. Thompson. You knew that Moshe Friedman, the butler of the Satmar Rebbe, was your biggest enemy. He took somebody to put on my picture with you, and then he took Gary Schlesinger to make fun of you. How in the world did you hug him in public? You don't understand what he did. Dov Hyken stood by your side because he was an enemy with Mr. Charles Hines. He figured we're going to push you in. Now he put you in one of his closest help, and his name is Mr. Shaul Sander. Now, I'm taking a disclaimer because I don't need lawsuits, but I heard from a very close relative of his, and he's also a relative of mine. And he quotes Mr. Sander as saying, we had to hit Rabbi Rosenberg hard to let Schnitzler walk because he is going to learn that he's not going to run this city. It's going to be run by rabbis, and if they feel that they want the sex freaks to be in the street and to extort money from them, they're going to be free to do that. Now, I can't quote this on a 100% basis. I have to take a disclaimer because he's a relative with Mr. Saunders as well, and then he's going to say it's not true, and I'm not here to take tape recorders and to make sure that I'm going to tell you. When you took him in on my hotline, I said in English, this is a grave mistake. You will look in 2 years worse than Mr. Charles Hines. See, Mr. Charles Hines was with these people, these untamed liars. He was with them for years. He knew how to treat them. At the end of the day, when Mr. Charles Hines wanted to put Boruch Matka Leibovich in prison, he didn't care that it's a first cousin with Moses Friedman. He put him there. Well, there was a goof-up with the government, intentionally or not, that they didn't deliver a certain paper on time. But he got his 32 years, and he is fighting for survival now. He also put Rabbi Nechemiah Weberman in jail. He locked him up and threw away the key. The man ain't never seen the sunlight in the free world. He also put a lot of people in jail that we know, Mr. Yagutkin, all these cases that we followed. Now, the Satmar community and the Lithuanian community came to him and they started, you know, tell him, do this, do that. Hey, he laughed in their face because he knew how to play the game. Mr. Thompson, you don't even know how to play the game. And then you have to understand, you took over a corrupted office. You'll have there maybe 50 or 60% enemies. So you have to take all this in consideration. You don't know who your friends are and who your enemies are. If you can give a hug for Moses Friedman in public, that shows that you don't know who he is. He's the one that tried to bring you down. He tried to bring me down. He tried to bring everybody down that doesn't go along with his corrupted policies. Now, the rabbis in our community tried to bring you down. They had a beautiful picture where all the rabbis are against you and they're on top. And the scale goes that you and I are on the same scale and we're on the bottom. I want to ask you a question. I really don't understand. How did these rabbis get under your skin? How did they get into your office? There's a Moskowitz case, which all the rabbis came into your office to vow for him that he's a very fine man. But I want to ask you a question. Did any of these rabbis say that when he allegedly is being accused of molesting his own children, did any of the rabbis say that they were with him 24 hours and they made sure that it didn't happen? So what good is it if they say he's a good man, a man of righteousness, and he learns Torah and he works? Does that mean he can't find 2 hours in the day to do sexual abuse? How did all these rabbis get in there? Did Mr. Sanders bring them in? Do you know that every one of these rabbis were against you? They were hoping and praying that you don't come in, that Mr. Charles Sainz will continue, and everything that went wrong until now should continue going that way? This is such a mind-boggling thing. I want to tell you, if you don't even know who your friends are and who your enemies are, how do you expect to succeed in such a big conglomerate office with hundreds of ADAs and law systems and everything? Well, anyway, I hope when you will learn who your enemies were and who your friends were, it just won't be too late, because it might be irreversible. Let's continue my story, and then we'll continue the story of Menachem Stark. But let's first continue my story. Easy Fried has inside connections in your office, as always, and I imagine that the other lawyer that they dumped was for a very simple reason, because he wasn't going to say a lie. Easy Fried and our community, I want you to remember this good, Mr. Thompson, our community thought you may lie, especially to the Gentile, and even if it's in court. Moshe Friedman, the one that you hugged him, he lied in court. You didn't pick him up. You hugged him. He lied in the grand jury, and when it came to give his testimony in court, he never appeared. You called him up. He didn't even answer you. And he's your friend. Wow. Mr. Charles Hines was not a Jew lover. In the beginning, he was very strict to them. Then, somehow, they got slowly but surely under his skin. Took him a lot of years. And then, Mr. Charles Hines saw how deep in problems he is in. Mr. Thompson, you didn't have that many years good that you should be able to afford such a fall down. So now, Easy Fried comes into your office. He doesn't. He's a lawyer, but he doesn't care. He can lie. Because it's Brooklyn. Because it's Mr. Charles Hines' primary office. Because it's now Mr. Thompson's office, which the rabbis got under your skin. I want everybody to hear what Mr. Easy Fried, the liar, the lawyer, said. And it's written in the New York Times and in all other papers. Israel Fried said his client had been cleaning the outside of his store with bleach that morning and had thrown the cup during an argument with the rabbi, not a premeditated act. The rabbi said there has been no argument. Okay, now, I would like to understand a certain thing. Mr. Schnitzler's store is on the even side. The store of the liquor where I walked next to is on the odd side. So how was I on the even side? Lie number one. But it makes no difference. These liars are so good with the DA that until now they were able to lie and they got away with it. And we thought it's only Charles Hines. Now we see Mr. Thompson is nothing better. The next thing. There's a video where somebody went over one of the newspapers to ask the liquor store what happened. And he explained exactly that I was walking from Division Avenue down next to his store. I never went to the other side. That video is public information. The New York Times found that video. It's in the air for 1.5 years. Does a lawyer, a liar like Mr. Izzy Fried have no legal responsibilities to check that out? He can come in and say a lie? Now, I imagine that that's the reason why the old lawyer left him, because he said, I didn't buy my license in a 5 and 10 cent mama papa store. So he wasn't going to lie, but Izzy Fried knows the system that in that office, in the DA's office, whether it was Mr. Charles Hines or now it's Mr. Thompson, we can get away with lies because the rabbis run the show and they love you and they threaten you and they promise you for future votes. Oh, this is very terrible news. I hope to sue Mr. Izzy Fried in the bar, in the Bar Association. The man is a blunt liar. Now, they told me that the reason why they didn't want to prosecute the case because it's my word against Schnitzler's word. That's a lie. There is a video of the man of the liquor store. He also testified in front of a grand jury 1.5 years ago, and I wondered why he wasn't called down now when they made this agreement. Then there's another thing. I, Mr. Rosenberg, told the ADA that I want my voice to be heard. He says, I'm sorry, they're in for an agreement already, and it's all prefabricated. I feel that they took away my civil rights of being heard. This is deadly wrong, Mr. Thompson. And I want to tell you something. One or two more mistakes like this, and you'll look worse than Mr. Charles Hines. He made a lot of bad mistakes, but he knew where to make them and where not to make them. These people must have told you, Rabbi Rosenberg is the crazy rabbi in the community. Don't worry. Make a deal. Show your power. Rabbi Rosenberg has nobody to talk to. But unfortunately, little did you know that all normal, nice, straight people are on my side, not on the rabbi's side. The rabbis are only maybe 5%. The animals, the pedophiles who run after our cute babies and children are only maybe 5%. The rest of them are very normal, nice, civilized people. Unfortunately, they're tortured by the rabbis, and that's the point that you'll have to start to learn. When you hear the voice from Williamsburg, and Moshe Friedman tells you, and the UJO tells you, Dov Heikin tells you, and Mr. Sanders tells you, that's prefabricated what the rabbis want you to hear. It is definitely not at all the voice of the people, especially the people who have children in the street, especially of the people that their children are being thrown out from private schools. They are 5, 6, 7, 8 years old. They have no education, and then they become drug addicts, and then they call me up, Rabbi, help, and I can't help them. This is such a messed up community, not only sexual abuse. The education is no good. I would like you to go into any high school from the Jewish people, or go in any satmar or yeshiva. If any boy or girl can read the simplest letter that a 5-year-old can write in public school, then you say, Rabbi Rosenberg, you're lying. I'll tell you a story. A person goes down after he got married, you know, he is going to take a wife, he doesn't have an education, doesn't know where to live for today and tomorrow. So he goes down to the welfare office. Thank God we have a beautiful welfare system. He goes in the office, he takes an application, and he says to his wife, you know, I see here it says N-A-M-E, and he's filling out the application. So he asks his wife, well, what does this mean? So his wife says, you know, you're great. I didn't even know that you can read N-A-M-E. Now, what do you want, that these people shouldn't become drug addicts? They're being kicked out when they're 9 and 10. It's an unfortunate thing. Now, Mr. Abe George, I was your friend, and I helped you out. And I hear you're the head of the narcotics. Let's not put everybody in jail. Let's stop this non-education of children. Okay, but let me continue. So, Mr. Izzy Fried said a lie. He said that it wasn't meant intentionally. He was doing his store work. When there's a witness that he's a liar, I was never on the other side. Okay, now let's go to lie number 2. Mr. Izzy Fried said that he has no prior arrests. You don't know him. He wasn't arrested because in this community they don't arrest. He's the sexton of a shul. He's a devil. He runs the shul. And he's the fighter for the Aaronites. He wasn't arrested. If anybody would arrest him, you know what would happen? He and his family would be ostracized. They would look like me. They would get hurt. They would get bleach in the face. And they would be assaulted. Every second car would try to run them over. But here again, on the books, he's a clean guy. Fine. Now let me ask you a question, Mr. Thompson. They just found the person who murdered Stark. Those are 3 people. They're from overseas. I think we should not arrest them because it's only the first time. And in fact, they shouldn't arrest all 3 of them. They should only arrest 1 because it's only the first time. And I want to ask you another question. You just picked up 5 Shomrim people that blind the eye of Mr. Patterson. I want to ask you a question. Why would you pick them up? It's only the first time. Well, if we don't care for the first time, hey, you can open the jail. 90% of the people would be able to walk out. What kind of nonsense is this that it's only the first time? And I want to ask you another question. Mr. Fried tried to show Judge Ingram that he is not going to obey him. He's going to make fun of his court system. So he was picked up, and he's out on bail. He was picked up now the second time with the Shomrim scandal. So wait a minute. So he should be the only one that you should take care of. You should not take care of the other ones because they're the first time. And also, another thing, right. The second time he got involved in their dealings. So wait a minute. So obviously somebody does it the first time, does it the second time. What kind of nonsense is this to accept that it's only the first time, and they didn't even call me down to tell me all these things? I wanted to defend myself. Mr. Schnitzer is the sexton of the shul of the Aaronites. I think it's a South 8. And he was told by the people to hurt me. And I have this from inside information, which again, I take a disclaimer. I'm not going to go sitting in court for all these nonsense with these lawsuits. They told me that after he did it, the people came and told me he didn't do it on his own. He acted on the synagogue, on the Aaronite. And they also told me that he became now a hero in the synagogue. So let's go further. His lawyer, Mr. Izzy Fried, said that because there is minor injuries or no injuries were left, that's why he can go free. And my ABA told me that also on the day when it was finally that he's getting the deal to walk. I told him, didn't I always tell you that I have resilient problems I have here all the time. I have to go around with these eye drops. I have so many residuals which I don't have to discuss in public. But there's a file. There's a file in a hospital where I go constantly. Is he to give a statement that there's no problems and I can't even come and defend myself? Yes, there is. And I can bring you the doctor's reports. And the doctors? This is an unheard of situation. I want to tell you something. Mr. Thompson, you know, in the time of Mr. Charles Hines, they didn't do such a disgusting job. I have a friend who I helped him to come forward. His son was molested, and they had Hannah White, and she was trying for hours to convince the man that the pedophile is only going to get 5 years. Which was a joke, but at least she tried to convince him. She had his saying. I didn't even have that. And if you remember, in the beginning I said, I don't want an Orthodox Jewish ADA, because I know the game. There are X amounts of shuls, X amounts of synagogues. They all need the money from the government when Mr. Hyken and all these other thieves solicit the funds. So they run every shul. Now, Mr. Farkas is a member of a shul. And it's very easy for these people, the Satmar, to find out where, what, when. And then all Dov Hyken has to call up, or anybody else, Moshe David Niederman or Moshe Friedman, and saying, listen, you tell Ari Farkas to keep his head on a low profile. And maybe this is what happened, because I feel very intimidated that I wasn't even notified until I went the morning of the court date. And usually people don't even come. They're being notified, they don't have to come. I was never notified, but I came anyway, because I go along to all the cases to give for all the victims a little support. So what kind of deal was this? I don't understand. Mr. Thompson, do you want to succeed the way you're going now? Hell, I'll tell you something. These rabbis are not here to help you. They're here to mess you up and to step on you, and that's what they're going to do. And obviously you still don't know the truth. You haven't learned our community. Mr. Thompson, when my friend Mr. Kellner, 3 years they tortured him, there were people like Moshe Gabay, Friedman, that you never picked up for lying. Ashkenazi brothers Zalman and Beryl, you never picked them up for lying. You also made friends with Rabbi Aaron Teitelbaum, who called this unfortunate, beautiful girl that everybody's heart goes out for, that she had to be a prostitute when she was 12. Otherwise, she would have been thrown out from Satmar school. I don't want to say her name. She's the victim of Weberman. And we have other victims. Mr. Charles Hines said he has 7, and Rabbi Horowitz for months, he said that he has... It's unbelievable. Do you really feel that Rabbi Aaron Teitelbaum is a serious, a sincere person, a holy person, a person that's not full of politics, ego, money? Is he the man that you have to go to? Try to take a look at the votes. Nobody in the Jewish community, almost nobody, voted for you. Not in Williamsburg and not in Borough Park. So how did they become your superiors now? So with all these lies, they were able to change from felonies to felony assaults? This is mind-boggling, and I am not going to take this with folded hands. Now let's continue. People try to tell me, don't worry, he has a felony assault. You know, in our community, a felony assault doesn't mean anything. If you remember the case of Menachem Mendel Deutsch, he went to jail, he came out, he's a registered sex offender, class 3, which is the highest. He moved to Muncie, and he goes there to the mikveh with children, he goes there to the synagogues with children, until I started on my hotline to hammer away that he's a registered sex offender. Now he's being chased out from one shul to another shul, but in our community, if you have a felony assault, it's a joke. He's a hero. You don't understand? George Washington, the first president of the United States, in the United States, he's a hero. But in England, he's not. So you have to understand, in our community, if the rabbis declare you that you're a no good man, even though they're doing evil, the community will go along with them. And because of that, we needed the government's help that it shouldn't happen. And the little that we got in the past 6-7 years of fighting, now the government blew it out of proportion. I can't even go in the street now. I have to go out of town for a few days. I can't even go in the street. It's unbelievable what's happening. I went into a store this morning, into a restaurant. I was bawled out. I had to run out before they would hit me, and then they would say, no, he started. You know the game that these people play. You know, we have liaisons in the 66 and the 90 precinct, and if somebody comes in and say, my child was molested, They would say, by who? They give him the name. Then the liaison would call up that man, go and make a counterclaim on this man. This is the way it's been running all these years. So a felony doesn't mean anything. Nothing means anything. He's not going to run to become the governor of the states where the felony would disqualify him. So, and maybe by that time, the DA will give him a note that it was all a hoax. You never know with these people what's happening. Money they have galore. They can buy off anybody. And we're in a terrible position. Mr. Ken Thompson, you promised that when you will become, that you will make sure there will be no guns in the street. I remember hearing the statement. Mr. Thompson, I read in the newspaper, Brooklyn newspaper, that on South 2nd, four small children, ages 6 to 14, were shot in the legs only last week, not in Charles Einstein. You were too busy, Mr. Thompson, to wine and dine these rabbis who were trying to tell you that Mr. Moskowitz is a holy man and you should let him walk without any jail term. And you were also busy to wine and dine these rabbis who told you that Mr. Schnitzler should walk. Why? Because he, his father, is a first cousin with Moshe Friedman. And that hug that he gave you, he finished you for life. Now you're his slave. Now let us get back to the real business. A person was killed in our community. His name is Meshillim Stark. On my hotline, I keep on saying the whole time, they'll never find who did it. And if they will, it'll be the same as Renta's case or all these other cases. They'll find somebody from overseas, which is here illegal, and then they'll send him back to where he came from, and they're going to say he's going to sit in jail wherever he came from. Lo and behold, a few months later, they find three people, that's what I read in the newspaper, they're here illegal, so they're going to deport them, and they're going to sit in Russia in jail. They're going to go in by the front door and go out through the back door. So people ask me, Rabbi, are you some sort of a prophet? How did you know that? I said, because the people who are involved in his killing are the highest profile
and the richest people
in Brooklyn. We know these families' names. I don't want to put down their names now because there was rumors that they investigated this family. These are the highest profile. I want you to know, Mr. Thompson, if they could have been friends with you a few more weeks or months, the end of the result would have been
that Mr. Stark committed suicide.
Just like we did to Mr. Renta and to all these other people. We put false people in jail and the real people, the killers, the murderers, are still in the street. That's exactly what they would have done. But obviously, you don't know them that close yet, so they were afraid to offer you deals. But they could have offered you that deal also. It's a shame for Brooklyn. What this teaches us is that we're not safe. First of all, we arrested tens of cases, and all these people were innocent. So obviously the killers are still out there. And on the other hand, Mr. Thompson, we feel very hurt that a person who belongs to be in jail for a lot of years, Mr. Myla Schnitzler, should walk out. Why? Because he's the nephew of Mr. Moshe Friedman. He's not rich. He's not a who is who. But because he's the nephew of Moshe Friedman, he can walk out on the street. Charles Heinz didn't make such a mistake. Charles Heinz told Moshe Friedman, I'm going to put Baruch Matkalibovich in jail even though he is your first cousin. There's a certain limit that we can go, and there's a certain limit that we have to face the public. What do you think? The public are stupid? We don't know what's happening? We know the inside politics of this whole community. So when I heard these fancy names who was involved, which I don't want to say it because I don't need lawsuits, I said right away, they will never find anybody. It was on my hotline. And if they will find, they will find somebody who didn't do it. And for a joke, I said, it's a good thing that Mr. Rent is in the street because now they can take him, pick him up again. This is a joke. Now, a lot of people tell me, don't worry. If somebody is on probation, he has zero tolerance. First of all, this is unsupervised probation. And second of all, in our community, nobody would come forward against anybody anyway because they see what's happening. What happened to Mr. Kellner? What happened to Rabbi Rosenberg? So, by us, the probation deal doesn't mean anything. Other people say it cost him a few $100,000. It's a joke. First of all, the first thing that Mr. Sander said to his relative, we made sure that it doesn't cost him that much. We took care of some of the money. We made sure that he's okay. And even if he didn't say it, we know that his father and Mr. Schnitzler, Jr., Mailer Schnitzler, went around to the synagogue, in all synagogues, and they were throwing money at them. Hey, you're a hero. Now, I want to talk constructive to Mr. Ken Thompson. There's a letter that you sent around for immediate release on February the 21st, year 2014. Kings County District Attorney Kenneth B. Thompson announces the appointment of 3 independent attorneys to assist in the review of cases involving alleged and unlawful convictions. Brooklyn, February the 21st, 2014, Kings County District Attorney Kenneth B. Thompson today announced the appointment of 3 attorneys to assist in evaluating the cases involved allegations of unlawful convictions. The 3 attorneys are Bernard W. Nussbaum, Jennifer G. Rogers, and Gary S. Villanova. They will consult with the Conviction Review Unit, that's the CRU, which has recently been expanded and reorganized. More information on the CRU will be confronting. District Attorney Thompson said, "I wish to thank these distinguished members of the bar for volunteering their service in the pursuit of justice. Their combining experience and uncompromising integrity will prove invaluable in my office efforts to meticulously examine available evidence in order to right wrongs or confirm convictions. My ultimate goal is to ensure that the people of Brooklyn have faith in the fairness of our criminal justice system." The panel will meet on an as-needed basis with the district attorney's office and review findings. Of individual cases that have been investigated by the CRU, they will advise on a range of issues, including whether a conviction should stand or needs additional review or should possibly be turned over. The CRU will consist of experienced prosecutors, investigators, and support staff tasked with the responsibility of conducting a thorough reinvestigation of cases identified as having a colorable claim of actual innocence or gross violation of defendant's constitutional rights. Did you hear this, Mr. Ken Thompson? Defendant's constitutional rights. In this case, they took away my constitutional rights. Bernard W. Nussbaum has been a partner at whatever the company's name is since 1966. He was consultant to President Bill Clinton from 1993 to 1994. In 1994, he served as a senior member of the staff of the House Judiciary Committee, which conducted the Watergate impeachment inquiry. He also served as an assistant United States attorney for the Southern District of New York. Mr. Nussbaum graduated Harvard, L.A. I want to ask you a question, Mr. Thompson. You feel very bad why these people went to sit for nothing for 16 years and 20 years and 21 years. Isn't it exactly the same crime to let a person that should be in jail, to let him free in society, that he can strike again? Mr. Thompson, you vowed that the black people would not be intimidated in department stores just because they're black. And we were all with you all the time. And we gave you moral support when you didn't have anybody to give you moral support from the Orthodox community. My question to you is, Mr. Thompson, if you would look close in my face, you would see I am black too. I am the black sheep of this community. They've been haunting for my life. They've been doing every bad thing possible for me and for my children. They were attacking my children at certain times. They did everything possible to haunt me out of here. I'm the black sheep. My friends, they made weddings for their children. I was called. I was threatened in front of the hall. If you dare step in here, we're going to kill you. And I want you to know, these halls are built in schools, which is all United States government money. This is all okay with you? You let a person like Melech Schnitzler to walk in the street? You don't know his history. You don't know his background just because he came crying upstairs in the DA's office? Well, think about it. Mr. Rubin also cried in that same office, and he got his 4 months, and he said maybe 3 months. When he came out, he was declared in our community as a hero, not as a total failure, not as a prisoner, not as a person who tried to intimidate a witness and the justice system. And I want to ask you a question. If Mr. Rubin got 4 months, he just tried to intimidate somebody, and he tried to defame the law system. Mr. Schnitzler did much worse than that. He intimidated an activist, which I have nothing to do with him personally, and he broke the law. He spilled bleach in my eyes.
not for God's mercy, I would be blind.
If anybody was to take a gun and shoot a fellow friend in the street, and the fellow friend happens to have a bulletproof vest, would you say because he wasn't hurt, he, the one that shot him, can walk away? I don't even understand not one of these principles why he was let go loose. Maybe you can give me the same team of attorneys that you put together. They should listen to me as well. And you should stop that judge before they give out the final sentencing. It's unfair and it's intolerable. And in the same time that these 10% minority rabbis and pedophiles are roaming me and running me around in the street, in the same time, the 90% decent people who want a safe community call me up and they tell me, don't break down, you have to continue. And just because you have a bumpy road doesn't mean anything. Mr. Thompson, if the road will be bumpy for me, it'll be bumpy for you, because 90% of people are with the right side. It's only the 10%, 5% rabbis and 5% pedophiles. It's about that percent, maybe a little more. Those are the people who are with you. And before you know it, you will be brought down in the whole Brooklyn.
Do you think, as an African-American reads the story
about what's happening in our community, they read the story about the bleach man that's walking. They read the story about Abraham Rubin that walked after 3 or 4 months from jail, and he became a hero. And they read that Neshillim Stark's killer will probably walk too, because the intention was just, you know, to tickle him. And he was too heavy, and because of his weight, he killed him. It's a shame, Mr. Thompson.
Also, Mr. Thompson, after your victory speech, my friend and I went over to you to congratulate you. We were very happy that you had such a successful victory. We gave you our full support, and we told you that we hope that the Jewish community and the whole entire Brooklyn will be very proud of you. And your answer was, yes, you will. I would like to ask you something. Mr. Thompson, do you really feel that we are very proud of you? Do you feel that the advocates for children's safety are proud of you? Do you feel that the borough of Brooklyn is proud of you with such decisions? It's unbelievable. I would like to explain to you something, Mr. Thompson. When you came into office, what you weren't in there yet officially, you said, I want Baruch Mordechai Leibowitz's case to be on my table because I want to go through it. Now they're offering Baruch Mordechai Leibowitz 2 to 6 years. Well, Mr. Charles Hines offered him the same thing. So why did you get involved in a war that you can't handle? And this does not make you look very competent.
We thought that you'll be much more successful, especially in the beginning. But obviously you have the wrong people advising you. And if you're not going to look around to see what's happening, and you're not going to take from the 90% normal people to help you in the office, to explain to you how this community works, to explain to you how these rabbis work, to explain to you how much extorted millions of dollars the government puts into this community, and Mishmeres Hatznias stole that money. There's not one billboard in our community saying safe sex, condoms, girls watch out, don't become pregnant. You don't see that. The rabbis say we teach that to the children, and therefore we deserve that money. And it's a lie. We have so many pregnancies, teenagers. We have so many abortions. We have so many
teenagers giving birth in many cases in overseas. There's also something that I want to discuss with you, Mr. Thompson, and this is very, very touchy. About 2 weeks before Passover, the ADA, Mr. Farkas, called me. I should come down to his office. He was telling me how he got promoted and everything. And then he says to me, by the way, would you want to bring any victims from Mr. Schnitzler's father that I claim that there is? Would you want to bring them up to the office? I felt very hurt when he did that. And I said to him a few things. First of all, if I will not bring any victims, or let's say I don't have any, does that mean that I don't deserve the right as a citizen to walk in the street without bleach in my eyes? Second of all, the same question that you asked me, the DA once asked Mr. Kellner, my friend. He brought 3 victims.
He bought Shruli Rubinstein, he bought Mr. Turnheim, and he bought a third victim who was also molested by Rabbi Borach Mordechai Leibowitz the Cantor. You know what the price he paid for this? Being 3 years under arrest, it cost him who knows how many hundreds of thousands of dollars for the lawyers. Why? Because he was a good man and he said, yes, we have more victims for Leibowitz. So what kind of nonsense is this to ask me if I want to bring victims? Do I want to look like Mr. Kellner? So then I asked him, tell me, do you know that I was asked this question about 3 years ago from Mr. Charles Hines people? And I said, what kind of protection are you giving me? I'm in the street, they're shooting after me, they're throwing sticks and stones after me, every car wants to run me over, I'm ostracized in an Orthodox community in Williamsburg, which has about 145 synagogues. I have no synagogue to go into. I have no ritual bear to go into. So what kind of protection will you give me? The rabbis in my community has ostracized me. Shame on themselves. Do you know that my blood is free for all? This is a hate crime. I was stripped from the congregation where I was a member for more than 30 years. I was stripped from being a member in the graveyard, which means after I die, I had a place there. I was stripped from everything. So I said to the person who was interviewing me upstairs on one of these floors, I said to him, wait a minute, what kind of protection will you give me? Now watch this, I said. For having a hotline and just teaching the people not to let these pedophiles bother you and to go to 911 to the police, they ostracized me. Can you imagine if I'll bring a boy or a girl to the police and I'll help them? You know what they would do to me? And beside of which, with knowing our community, they will tell the boy, you know, tell him that Rabbi Rosenberg had an affair with you. He had anal sex with you. You know one of the miracles that happened to my friend, Mr. Kellner? Baruch Mordechai Leibowitz could have used this tactic on him as well. And that was a miracle from God because he spoke up for the rights of the children. You don't know our community. You don't know what happens with these liaisons. They'll bring you 15 witnesses that, on the contrary, not the person that raped them was the ones that raped them, because the Hatzolah and the Shomrim do this all the time. They hide the evidence. The police can't talk to these girls because the rabbi is saying, hey, it's against modesty to talk to a girl about her sex that she had. She didn't have sex. She was raped. These stupid idiots rabbis don't know the difference between a rape and sex and love. They know nothing. Well, at least they don't want to know anything. So I said, wait a minute. I wouldn't get involved in this. I stay very far from the children. I don't talk to them on a personal basis. I don't talk to any women and to any men on a personal basis, only on the phone. So everything is recorded, and I can only offer them that if they want to go for help, they don't know where to go, or they don't know the language, I will have somebody together with me, two people will go along, we'll meet you outside of the precinct, and we'll go in. I don't go with you by car, I don't go with you by train. You don't know our community. You know, Mr. Thompson, when you learn our community, you'll see that Moshe Friedman one day might say that you raped a Jewish woman. Watch and see. You don't know the community. And if he won't say it, it'll also be a miracle. You don't know them. So anyway, let's just continue. So all of a sudden, the Daily News and the other newspapers are quoting that I don't help children, sexual abuse, I'm only an advocate. So wait a minute, what does this have to do with the price of beans in China? You know what this makes me feel like? That the government, your office, Mr. Thompson, wanted to use me for a free detective to bring you in people one by one, give me no protection, and then your grade will go up. Home. Mr. Thompson is doing against child sexual abuse. Wow, he's arresting one by one. Mr. Thompson, before you'll make an arrest, you'll go through a lot of bumpy roads, and at the end of the day, you'll be lucky that they won't accuse you on it. So make sure that if you ever talk to any of these rabbis or to any of these personnel, make sure you have in your office a video, make sure everything is recorded, and also make sure that you don't go out with them for luncheons, because you might run into a big problem. Okay, I concluded my speech. Again, I'm very hurt. I don't know if Mr. Thompson Thompson will listen to this, or his help will listen to this, or they will listen, and Mr. Sanders will tell him exactly the opposite of what I say, I don't care. If you don't have a time to find out who you're dealing with and what you do this should really be, then you know what? When the public will understand that the Brooklyn DA is not doing his job rightfully, and there's muggings in the street, there's killings in the street, there's gunshots for 4, 5, 6, and 8 year olds on South 2nd Street, then you'll learn the hard way who your friends are and who your enemies are and what is really the DA's job. I also want to tell you that I heard from a family member of Mr. Sanders. He told me that Mr. Sanders, in a family affair, he was raving and taking credit that he was the one that gave the lawyer Mr. Israel Fried for Mr. Schnitzler. And he was saying it only cost $5,000. And wow, what a knockout for Rabbi Rosenberg. He was explaining how he did such a terrific job. I also would like Mr. Thompson, with all the respect, to investigate this matter as well. If the lawyer Izzy Fried was given by your office, that means that he had all the rights to take any kind of deal without any jail. But the question is this why the government is paying money for a Jewish liaison? To get a lawyer for the crooks and the criminals and to give him a sweetheart deal so that he can make a living on this? This is a shame. If this is true, he should be fired the next morning. But investigate this first. You'll find out that basically Hannah White was the Jewish liaison. She was a female, a crook like you never in your life saw, a liar through her teeth. And Mr. Sanders is the liaison and he's a male. But basically we just changed from a female to a male. But I think they're the same crooks. Okay, with this I will stop and conclude my speech. Mr. Thompson, you still have a lot of work to do. And make sure that your work is fair and realistic for everybody in Brooklyn. There's no reason a Jewish liaison should give lawyers. And there's no reason he should be a Jewish liaison. He is here to back the rabbis, the pedophiles, and not the victims, and not the families of the victims. Thank you very much, and have a good day. Bye-bye.